Cool. Want to take over for comprising multiple file sets?
So what am I talking about?
Compiling multiple file sets and functions.
Alright, let's see how this goes. So do I just write lots of them? Hi everyone who doesn't know me, I'm Sarah. I tutor, teach words, first year courses. I'm a little bit asleep, so forgive me. That is written tall. Okay. So, what do you guys know about compiling? Like, I sort of expect that you want to have to compile things since you're still here. If you can't compile things at this stage, it's a little bit concerning. But compiling, like, it's, you guys think it's pretty easy, right? So, I just compile files. But actually, it can be kind of complicated to compile, especially multiple files at once. So, what do you guys know or not know already about this? Like, are you all complete wizards at writing your own make files and stuff, or a little bit? Alright, so let's say I'm compiling, it's a simple program, did start from scratch. So I've got like this.c, and it's just named like a main function that prints out a model or something like that. So the way I compile this, hopefully you guys all know, hopefully I get it right. GCC is the, like, the compiler that we use. And then we have a bunch of things that go in any order. So one of them is the file name. One of them is dash o and then the name of the program we want to commit. And if we forget this, then it will be called a or out. So this lets us call it like text or whatever we want to call it. And then dash wall and dash where. So wall turns on warnings all. And where means that warnings become errors, so you can't ignore the warnings. You have to get them to compile. This is all understood, hopefully. Alright, but what about when we compile multiple files? So as an example of that, we might have, you know, what do you guys do when I want to settle with this? Like, maybe we have like la.c, I'm really good at naming things. And inside la.c we have so we have la.c, which contains a function called func, and then that returns a times 2, that's what I wrote, and so la.h will just contain the prototype. So you guys are familiar with how I can have two files and then each file that contains the prototypes, which are the functions without the actual code in them. Yep.
We need to hash include that a lot.
Yes. Just testing you guys, clearly. So if we were including a library file, so like if we wanted to use printf or whatever, we'd use the triangle brackets, the angle brackets. But because this is a file of ours, it's not in the library, we're going to just use speech marks. Cool. And then test.c will also... include la.h. And so now this means, if we can compile it, right, test.c can call the function func even though it's in a different file. Does this match up with what you want? Am I making stuff up? Is this okay? Cool. Right, so how do we compile this then? Like, that's the big question. What do we need to do to make this work as part of this? Anyone have any guesses?
Make.
Yes, so we could just type make. That would magically do it all for us. Well, maybe not with two files.
Pray to Jesus.
What did you say?
You can pray to Jesus.
Pray to Jesus?
Yeah.
We could, yes. I don't know if that would help, but it's definitely one option.
Yeah.
So one thing we could do is write a make file, but I can't do that off the top of my head. I don't know if you have to do that for this course, but I didn't when I loved this course, so that's a good. But we can modify our compile line here. So we still want it to be called a test. We still want it to use test.c, but we also want to use blah.c. So if we also add this onto the end of our line, my homework is right, I have a number somewhere that says once. Is this is right? Someone? Yes? No? Michael, this is right. You just add the name of the other file, right?
What?
So this hash includes this .h file and XSC file for it. So I just add that into the list compile arguments.
That the hash includes that argument?
No, no, if this is my GCC. Is that valid? This is why I shouldn't be doing this, because I haven't compiled C in a very long time.
Yes.
Now, I'm going to go with, I think this is right. Yep.
To what extent is the order of each of the orders?
The order of these things is any order you want, but you can't forget that dash o test goes together. So dash o and then the name of the binary file. So that's the only one that goes together. Like all of the little boxes I've drawn, any order you like. The common mistake that people make, and people will make in the exam, if you have a practice exam, but you will make this mistake in an exam at some point. Don't do dash o test.c. Because if you're, you know, tab completing, or you know, you like dash o test tab to complete the test.c, this will overwrite your C file with your binary file, with your compiled code. So you will completely lose all of your source code. So be very, very, very careful when you're doing compiling in an exam. Cool. Life pro tip. Do you guys ever have a practice exam or is it just theory?
Oh, we had practice.
Yeah, you had practice already.
Yeah.
Cool. Are there any questions about this? I swear I'm actually qualified to teach this. And I'm not just a crazy person on the screen. I swear. Yeah? Yeah. What did you say? We need to have, like, this file by itself, it doesn't need it. But if we also call it up somewhere else in here, so we might have, like, and that might call function 2. But if this is above this function, so it happens in the file before that function was, the minute of the prototype that so just with this and not with this, we don't need this line at all. So the difference, if we just had these two files and not this one, it would be nice. That'd be the same. If we've got a separate file, there's definitely call this function, because that needs to know about the function somehow. It needs to look immediately, rather than having it fixed twice. Like once in there and once in this file, we put all the little file and then it could cool. Are there any more questions about compiling stuff? Oh, stack frames. Alright, so people listening, hello, I'm like a crazy person. If I say stack frames, do you guys get scared and a little bit frightened? Cool. That's my favorite audience to teach stack frames to. So I am a very strange person, and C is my favorite language, and I really love learning about memory and stack frames and stuff. So with like a disclaimer, Ellen draws the stack frames upside down to how I draw them, and I'm going to draw them my way because I think my way is right. So in the exam, you stand over here and draw the diagrams up the other way. I might draw them both ways, just to. So this is memory. Where should I start? I guess like this rectangle, it's all memory, right? So your computer has memory. You can access this in your files, so you can make an array that will go in memory. Your code will go in memory. All that stuff. This roughly correlates with RAM, if you guys know about RAM in your computer. So RAM is where the memory is stored. but the amount of RAM you have and the amount of memory you have aren't always the same. So in a 32-bit computer, which is an older computer, like you guys probably had 64-bit computers, but in a 32-bit computer, this thing called the address space, which is all the addresses that you can actually pretend you can access in the file, that goes from 8 zeros, which is 0, through to 8x, which is 2 to the 32 bit. Each of these is a memory address, which contains like one byte, and you can access that many bytes in memory. So your computer, this is equivalent to 4 gigabytes. Now your computer might not have 4 gigabytes of RAM, so like back on, you know, Windows XP days, you'll have like 512 megabytes. So it's really cool what happens. This is your address space, which is what your program thinks it has in terms of memory. And this might be your actual RAM. So this might just be 512 megabytes. So that's like an eighth as big or something. That's hard. So what's really cool about this is that your computer actually deals with all this stuff for you. So you might have noticed, like, you can run multiple programs at once, right? So you can run your Hello World program, you can run like Microsoft Word, you can run like Google Chrome. So you can have all these programs running at the same time. And each program thinks it has the full address space, the full folder for it. So you can access, like, maybe you've got an address on the stack, which we'll get to in a minute, around here-ish, and that'll be like, I don't know, an inch four. So that address might be like 0x, BFF of ABCD or something. And you can have another program as well that has the same address number, so the variable in the same address, but those are actually two different variables. They're in different places on your physical memory. So your program thinks it has this full focus to itself, but it doesn't necessarily correlate to the physical memory. So what happens, that was clever, in your operating system, it divides these up into chunks of a certain size and then slots those into your RAM wherever they'll fit, according to like special stuff. But it sounds interesting, take operating systems, it's a really fun course. So it divides it up into things called pages of a certain size, and then like let's grab some codes. So you've got this one, and this one, and then I've got the creative that can be strips. So pretend we've got all our memory divided up. The computer will fit these into RAM wherever they fit. So they might not be in the same order, or even, might not even have all of them. So that could be this one. And so the other thing you notice, if you've got 512 megabytes of RAM, but 4 gigs of address space, how does it all fit in RAM? Were you guys thinking that? Pretend you were thinking that. Like, it's going to be so interesting, and I'm going to answer your questions. Cool, right? So what happens is the ones that don't fit in memory, so when memory is full, the extra ones will go on your hard drive. And it's your operating system's job to map between them and to shift things in and out. Cool? Does that make sense? Cool. Haven't got stack frames yet, but does this make sense? Like, you're all good with this? Cool. Did you learn about this in lectures?
Probably not quite the pages and stuff.
Yeah, well, it's very cool. It's very exciting. Okay, so back to stack frames. So in our address space, which is our memory, but it's not necessarily our physical RAM, it's the virtual memory that our program has, we have a bunch of regions. They're about here and here. So that's about 0x0h. And that's about 0x. And I'll draw it upside down as well. So this is the real world, and then this is your town in red. So this is 0, this is 4 gigabytes, so this is 'Kay. Colors on the wrong list, that's okay. So, do you guys know what a stack is supposed to be? Not in terms of memory, but in terms of the data structure. You learned about stacks. They're pretty simple, right? You add things on top. I don't have anything I can stack. I have a phone in my pocket. So a phone. Okay. I'll make a stack. So, you put things on top. and my cube would balance out if I couldn't put it on because of hands. And then you take things off of that as well. So it's like having an actual table in front of you with books stacking on. You can only take the first book, because if you took the bottom one, the table would fall open, like the stack of books would fall open, and that would be that. Right? So your computer has a similar sort of stack, which is how it stores things called stack frames in your program. So the stack starts around here and grows upwards. So in exam world, that is a green panel. No, it's a green lid. I am so confused. This is the stack here, and it grows downwards. So it might be like this big, getting bigger, and this one is like this big, getting bigger. So it's down towards the higher numbers in memory. So further away from the zero, closer to the two, to the folding side, growing up towards zero. Cool. And so as we add on our stack frames, we'll get to in a minute what they actually are, we add them on top of the stack going up. So it grows up in this world and it grows down, up, down. I don't know how people in this world think about it. But basically, your stack frames will grow. All right, so does that make sense? We have things called stack frames, which we haven't explained what they are yet, and they grow like a stack. Yeah?
Sorry, why is going up? Why is going down?
Okay, so this is how real people. Sorry, that's offensive. This is how Sarah does it. And this is how, like, lecturers think about it. So I keep writing about this to people, and I really shouldn't write too much. But basically, if you think about a stack, right, stack of books on a table, you put things on the stack, and it grows up this way. Similarly, your stack frames, in this way of looking at it, grow up this way. Whereas in this world, which is what Alan Blair has in the exam, so if you're asked in the exam, you've got to think about the red diagram, not the black one, the stack grows down this way, which to me, like, it's kind of weird, because stacks don't, like, anti-gravity, maybe? But, I don't know. Yeah, so, what was I thinking about? Right, so the reason you might ask, why would anybody do it the backwards way? And there is a reason, and that reason is because little endian numbers look less confusing. So you remember talking about endianness before, and there's the ones that look like numbers that humans would have? So this is our 4-byte bin. That's all zeros. You could have like 0000001 would be 1. And this is called big endian. I always get them mixed up. But this is the way that humans do it. Whereas the way that computers do it, the order within the byte is still the same, but the bytes themselves move. So this one moves over here, this one moves over here. Like this. So this is going to be 0000001, and then a bunch of zeros. So you should remember this from like half paragraph. Can you see down the bottom? Should I write higher? I'll try and write higher. So the one good thing about drawing your memory upside down is that when you have numbers written in memory, they seem to be up the right place. They look like they go this way. So it makes them easier for humans to read. That's not a good enough reason, in my opinion. Anyway, we could argue about this, but that's silly. What I was going to talk about was stack frames, which is like the key point of my little story. So does anybody know what a stack frame is? Like, hopefully all of you do, but that's why I'm here, because you probably don't. So a stack frame is how your program stores. Where did the lid go? Sorry, I'm very distracted while I'm working. So stack frames are how your program stores what's going on in memory. So any local variables, that's a thing. So I'm going to write up here. Can you see if I write like along the sections?
Yeah.
So this is a kind of pointless program, if you guys can read my horrible writing. We have main, which calls fun1 and then fun2, and then just calls fun3. Fun3 does nothing, and fun2 also calls fun3, which does nothing. So it's a completely pointless program, but it should illustrate this concept. Let's pretend that A starts at like 5. So what happens is, when we run our program, it starts off by making a stack frame for a thing called start, which is the thing they call the main. That's all you need to know about it. So we have this stack frame here for start, and that just sits there. And so then when we call main, we get a stack frame on top of it for main. And so a stack frame is made every time a function gets called, and it stores all the local variables for that function. So in this case, it's going to store at A. So A equals 5, it's going to be in main. And then main calls fun1, so we get another stack frame. And that has no local variables, so it doesn't get anything inside it, and that calls fun3. And then fun3 is here, and again, that is nothing. So, as you can see, we've called a bunch of functions in a row, and we've got all these stack frames growing up here. So whatever local variables we have inside our functions, let's maybe make, like, int b equals 9. So then when our function 3 returns, and it doesn't return any value, it just returns itself, what happens is this gets erased, and now we're inside fun1 again. But you'll notice that the actual numbers in memory don't get erased, they just stay there for later. So if anything wants to access that memory later on, it can, and it'll get whatever happened to be there before. Right, so fun1 calls fun3 and then returns. So this one here goes away. And now we're back in main. And so main's going to call fun2. So can you guys guess what's going to happen next?
Fun2 goes on the stack frame.
Yes, thank you. Should have brought candy to like give you guys your answers. That was my mistake. Okay, so fun2 goes on the stack. And then fun2 calls fun3. So again, goes on the stack. And so you'll find that if we tried reading this variable before we assigned a value to it, we would be able to get whatever value was in there before. So that's potentially bad. So then fun3 is going to return, fun2 is going to return, and then main is going to return 0 at the end, so that gets erased. And now we're back inside start, and start's going to return, and then our program's finished, so now we're back to the terminal. Does this make sense? Cool. So if I ask any random person in the room, what is the stack store? Can you answer that question for me? Is someone who hasn't answered questions yet want to try and guess? So what is the stack store? If you like when we get multi-choice, does the stack store things that are malloc? Yes or no? Yes? No? People who are too afraid to answer, what do you think? Not sure? Right, so I haven't said malloc yet, so it's probably not going to be malloc things. What about local variables? Yes? No? Right. So, thank you for being brave enough to answer. As you can see from the diagram as we were going through, we had the local variables stored on the stack frames. So those are the things that get made inside the function. So whenever a function itself contains a variable that you can only access inside this function, that goes on the stack. Does that make sense? You look very good. Does any of it make sense? Yeah, they do get thrown away. So thrown away in the sense is you can no longer access them because they could get overwritten. So if we'd stored something important in here, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then that function returns, and then a different function gets called, it's going to overwrite this something else. So if we had a pointer pointing to that and then we tried to access it, we'd find that actually we'd get random garbage of whatever happens to be here now. So that's what we mean by random garbage. Like if you imagine, if I have a pointer, and I have a pointer, and I'm pointing to you, and then you leave, and then someone else comes in, like the next class comes in or whatever, I'm going to be pointing to the new person in your seat. So that's dangerous, because you might still be here, like you happen to be here now still, but it might be someone else, and we can't guarantee that. Whereas if we wanted you to be careful, like to be kept somewhere, we'd put you like in a throne and say, okay, now you're on the heap, so you're mallet, you're going to stay here, and then you'd have to stay here forever. You wouldn't be allowed to go home until we've reached you. So that way I can say, look, he's still here, I think. Does that make sense? And then I could eventually say, okay, now you're free, and then we go. you have to stay here for like 5 hours and study your report. Okay, does that silly little anecdote make sense? Yes, no, maybe? Someone's nodding and smiling. What's your name, by the way?
Jacob.
Thank you for nodding and smiling. It's great for my confidence. Alright, so stack frames store local variables, and they grow up on top of each other. And then once the stack frame is exited, so once a function is exited, the variables in here can be overridden. So you can't store important things on the stack unless they're still within your thing. So we can access main. So important things we can't store on the stack. So then you might be thinking, where do we store them? Does anybody know the answer? Jacob, do you know the answer? Thank you, Nate. So, I'm going to pick on you so much from now on. You should have told me your name. So we have our stack frame down here. And that goes up this way. And then we have our heap, which is here, and it grows downwards. And eventually, if they both get too full, they'll smash in the middle, and you can't allocate any more memory. But as long as it doesn't happen, and you've got like a full 2 gigs of space, it's probably not too good. So the heap is where we store both things like constants, so strings. So whenever you have a program, like if you print it, you know, speech marks hello world, the words hello world will be stored on the heap. And additionally, if you malloc a variable, that's also going to be stored. So if in our example here, we went malloc size of inch. Then even when the stack frame wait not the same, if we put that in fun3. Even when fun3 is returned, we can still access that variable X, so we can pass that pointer back somewhere else if we want, and it'll still be there. Does that make sense? Cool. Smiling, nodding. Alright. So do you guys understand stack frames a little bit more now? Do you think if you had an exam question saying what's a stack frame? You could go like that thing, stare around for about for half an hour. Hopefully. Right, and I'll just do it on the red diagram. Let's see. So, once again, in your exam, the bit down the bottom is the heap, and the bit up the top is the stack. And they grow towards each other. So these parts on the outside are reserved for Right. Are there any more questions about this?
Where did Michael go? I guess I'll just keep going down the list. You guys have done functions and arrays and pointers and stuff in 1917, right? Cool. I sort of talked about functions there. Do you want me to talk about functions some more? What did you say? If I can find it. Is it under the sample written exam? Like week 13 lectures? Sample exam? Okay, which question? The one on stack frames? Yep. People are leaving? I'm so sad. That was not what I expected to happen. So this question is the one you met. People who wanted questions. There's probably words on the question actually. Hi, Michael.
Okay. So copy the diagram below into your book and use it to draw a memory map, showing where the variables are stored, static and variables. So given these declarations, we have static int k, int l, and int a star equals malloc and int. Where would these be stored in our stack frames? So you should all know the answers to this now because I've rambled about it for half an hour. Does anyone want to take a guess? You'll notice that 0 is down the bottom, which is opposite to what I did. So this is the red one, not the black one. Does anyone want to take a guess?
42?
That's a good guess. If I had chocolate to give you, I would give you chocolate for that guess. But unfortunately, I don't. I will bring that in next time. Alright, so I guess we have a couple of regions. We have this one, and this one. And we also have a pen with which we can draw on the screen. I might not do that. Can I wind the thing up? Do you want to just hold it up? Actually, does someone want to come and do this so I can write? Thanks. I don't know if you can hold it up high enough. There we go, cool. So this is a beautiful diagram. Okay, so we have this region, and this region, and we can draw lines on. So where am I going to draw a line? And what am I going to call? What am I going to label? So let's start with this one. Does anything go in here? No? Right. Does anything go in here?
Yes.
Yes? Alright. What goes in here? Do I draw a line somewhere? Should I draw a line? Yep. Draw a line here? Yeah. Cool. What goes in this part here?
Study.
Yeah. The heat. Which consists of static, dynamic, and local variables. So, does this have static, dynamic, or local variables in it? Or some combination? Do you say dynamic? Yes, that's right, but what's the other right answer as well? Static. Cool, you're both right. All right, so which one goes where, do you guys know?
Static and the bottom.
I think so. Let's draw it offline. Cool, and this grows up like this. Alright, so we still need local variables. So should I draw another line somewhere, or should I just label this part? Am I going to label this part, or am I going to draw another line here?
Draw a line.
Cool. So I get some much for the last one. So what's this region here called? The stack, perfect. And this is going to have what inside it? Very good. Which you also knew because we've already done the other two. But, you know, you can definitely think it's it. Cool. And then this one stays one. Do you guys think you could draw this in the exam? Like, it'd be easier for you guys because you don't have a light shining in your face and you're not trying to hold it. So, like, if I could do it in these conditions, surely you guys could do it in the exam. But does this make sense? We also had some variables. So we have K, L, and A. So where's K going to go? It's a static int. It's pretty simple. It's written on the board already. Cool. Just checking you guys are awake. So K is going to go there. So which of these is local and which of these is dynamic?
L is the local.
Yep, cool. L for local. Gives it away a little bit. So that's going to go over here. It's an L, not an accent. It might have to be an accent. Which leaves us with this malloc thing. So this is going to be dynamic by process of elimination, but also it's going to be dynamic because it's like dynamically allocated. That is so blinding. I don't know why I'm on that still. So that's going to be starting. Cool. So you guys just got how many marks this is. You got 4 marks. Well done, guys. Do you have a question? What did you say?
No. So, Jenk, I bet you know this. What goes in these parts of memory? I can't scroll. Is that, like, what's below the stack? And is this always reserved, or is that only a...
That's always reserved.
But is that the physical, or the... So the actual compiled code,
yes.
Like the bytes of your compiled code, go into part of memory.
You access that?
You can, but you probably can't write to it, hopefully.
You should be able to write to it.
If you're NX bits, yeah. Cool. And I think I might have seen libc up there, but libc's probably around here, I don't know.
Libc is down here.
Yes, down, up. Top, bottom. You stand on your head to knees now. Alright, let's turn... Should we leave this on? I've talked about functions a lot, right? Do you guys want me to talk about functions more, or are you happy with functions? What about arrays?
Pointers?
Yeah. 15% of people want to hear about pointers. I'll see if there's any pointer questions in the exam. These look like pointers. Alright. So, I'm going to ramble through this first. I'm blinded again. Should have brought sunglasses on. Alright, so, listening guys, what is a pointer? Like, this is a strange word that I've said like 5 times now. What is a pointer? What do we use it for? Are any of these pointers? Am I a pointer? Like, is this a pointer? Does someone want to explain and put me out of my misery? I forgot it was a Jacob.
Yeah.
Do you want to explain what a pointer is?
It's an address in memory.
Alright, guys, listening to Jacob, please. He's been very good talking to us.
It's an address in memory that we can use to, I guess, access whatever is in that memory or move around in memory around that space.
Perfect answer. So, yeah, it's an address which we can use to access something or which we can use to move around. So if I'm pointing at you, I am a variable with an address in memory. If this room is like memory, I have an address and it's like on the front. Jacob's in the address, which is like 2 rows back, and I'm pointing at him. So what value do I hold if I'm pointing at him? If I hold his address. So let's get like 5 volunteers up the front. Hey, Josh.
Yeah.
Can you get the idea in my standing and I'll pay you back?
Yeah.
Is that too far? Because we're doing 1-on-1-7 stuff still.
Yeah.
Thanks. So, Candy with Josh is going to go and buy if you guys come up and volunteer. Do you want to come up? 5 people? It's 1 person. Does anyone else want to come? Jacob? Do you want to come? A few more people? And does someone have some paper that I can have? I'm going to give you guys some papers.
What kind of candy?
Oh, whatever. I think Starbursts are special or something. So this is your value. This is your value. It's going to make 4 as well. Alright, I should have not used a wipe marker, but it's okay. So if we are memory. It starts at address 1, 2, 3, and 4. So, like, you're standing in spot 1, 2, 3, and spot 4. Alright, so, I am a pointer. I have the address 4, so I should, like, write above my head, like, you know, Akazan Sarah evaluates the 4. Like, I am in spot 4. I've got, like, mailbox number 4, so I have my address is 4. But I'm pointing to Jacob, whose address is 2, which means the value that I store is 2. My value. Address 4, written above my head and imaginary words. Alright, so what's your name?
I'm Ben.
Ben. So Jacob, do you want to point to Ben? Do you want to like put a number down? So Ben is at address 3, which means that like ampersand Ben gives you 3. His value is unknown currently. So you're pointing. So effectively we have this sort of thing going on like this. Cool. Now, what's your favorite number that's bigger than 4?
13.
13, alright. You can hold the value 13.
write it upside down and messily. Cool, and then you can just do black for the moment. We'll get to you. Alright. So, what happens if I dereference myself? So if I write star Sarah, what value is that going to give you? What does a dereference mean, first of all?
Your address?
Yeah, so it's following the value that I hold and going to that address. Is that a 2 or 4? Okay, that's been... So that's following along my value that I'm pointing to and getting the value out from Jacob. Haven't forgotten your name yet. That's good. Right, so star Sarah will give you 3 because that's the value that he's holding. Maybe I'll put this up. I can write it, yeah. So we have... gives you the address of Jacob. Cool.
And just Sarah gives 2?
Yep, and so if we type Sarah, that gives... Hang on. That gives you Jacob. This one gives you the address of Jacob. And if you type the address of Sarah, that gives you the... Cool. So what happens if we write star Sarah? So I'm pointing to Jacob and Jacob's pointing to Ben. So what does star mean? Anyone? Shouldn't have looked at people like, Yes, the star means double dereference. That means you go along where I'm pointing to Jacob, and you go along where Jacob's pointing to Ben, and you get that value. So that gives you the value of 13. So star Sarah equals 13. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Star means follow along the first pointer, take the second thing, interpret that as a pointer, follow along there, and then get that value.
What is star
Sarah? Sorry, what did you say?
Star,
so that means follow along me and get the value of the thing that I'm pointing to, which is 3 in Jacob's hand. Cool. What about star Sarah? Nothing is not a good answer. Let's try it. Okay, are you guys ready? Star Sarah. You know both explorers. So what just happened here? Segmentation talk. Perfect. So we dereferenced invalid pointer. So 13 is not, like, our memory contains 1, 2, 3, 4, and an imaginary null sitting over there for us to load things up with. So 13 is, like, not a number that exists in our memory. So when you try to go to address 13, it goes, I don't know, it's not inside the segment, and it gives you a segmentation talk. Does that make sense? What about if... this happens? So now we have star Sarah. Follow me along to Jacob, follow Jacob along to Ben. Follow Ben along to... what's your name?
Jason? Yep.
Jacob. Jason.
Yes.
I'm going to forget both of your names now that it's too similar. Okay, so follow us along and then we get to you. What's your value?
Nothing.
You don't have a value, you're uninitialized. So what happens if a value is uninitialized? Yeah, it'll have whatever happens to be there already, because we're on the stack. Well, maybe, probably on the stack. And I'm not quite big enough, then it's okay. So what value do you want to have? You can have 0.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm not very good at drawing, but yeah. That's a 0. Just trust me on this.
If it's uninitialized, it won't have any value.
It will have our value, but we don't know what it is. So let's say it happens to be 0, because we're really lucky. All right, so what about star 0? What's going to happen with that?
Is that 4 stars?
I think so. Star. It's not more than last time.
So,
I don't know.
So
we're going to dereference me to get Jacob. Cool. And that's 1 star. We're going to dereference Jacob to get to Ben. That's 2 stars. We're going to dereference Ben to get to Jason.
Yeah.
It's 3 stars. And then we're going to dereference Jason. So what happens now? We've dereferenced to 0. Set fault is like, because the computer's being nice and it's catching it before it destroys the universe, it actually destroys the universe. Like, trust me on this one. Is that a question?
Yeah. Can you have a pointer that points to a pointer that points to
a carrying another pointer? Should we try and see? So I'm going to point to Jason or Jacob? Jacob. I can't handle this. And now you're going to point to me.
Yep.
So, turn it up the other way. So what do you want to do? If you print out Sarah, you get a 2. Looks like a 4 from behind. It's pretty confusing. You get a 2. And if you dereference me, you get Jacob, who has the value of 4. If you dereference, so ** Sarah, Jacob dereferences back to me, it's going to give me the value 2. **, it's going to be back at Jacob, it's going to give me the value 4. **, going to be back at me, **, back at Jacob. What happens if we have a while loop that says, like, you know, int *current equals Sarah, while current does not equal null, current equals dereference current. So like the linked list, but with pointers. What's going to happen with that?
Threes and fours and
yeah, it's going to infinite loops. It's going to dereference both of us and jump around and around and around. You're like, me, there's so many variables, I'm so excited, and then eventually it'll crash.
Would it crash when the stack reaches the
If there was a function call involved, then yes. If we were making new stack frames, then that would definitely crash it. Like, we'd run out of stack space, and then we'd crash because we'd be out of stack frames.
What would make it crash?
So just making stack frames, like if you remember on the diagram I had before, it's a finite size, so once it gets full up, it can't get any bigger.
But if you weren't using functions?
Yeah, so if we're not using functions, if we're just in a loop, what's going to happen?
Keep going.
It's going to keep running. Has anybody ever written like an infinite loop accidentally and that's like did
something
like
that
or something
that just
stays forever? Yeah, it'll run forever. Well, not forever, like eventually the universe will end. Up until that one. Does that answer your question?
Can you please show the answer for question 6 that has some pointers?
I think you can. Which one's this? The mouse is very confusing. It's like upside down.
Hey, Michael.
This one's fun. All right. So you guys, thank you for being pointers. You can sit down. Shall we have a round of applause? So, Ben, Jacob, and Jason. Cool. Go away. Alright. I think I'm going to need a whiteboard for this. If I write on this one, can you guys see what I'm writing? Jackie Burns.
Hello.
Thank you. Do you distribute some candy to the people who helped?
Oh, I was going to give it to you.
Okay, that works good. How much do I do?
It's on a piece of paper.
Cool.
Minus this.
Minus the data.
This is mine.
Alright. Fruit chews or steaks?
Thanks,
man. The one that's not in my hand, of course. You're dead. Yeah, I can't help you do a pop-up in this, so it's really hitting. Alright, so there's more stakes if you guys good on answer questions or something. I don't know what's going on here. Okay. Alright, so, first things first, you're in the exam, you're sitting there thinking, oh no, I'm in an exam, I'm pretty stressed out, like, I'm stressed out of here, maybe you guys aren't stressed. So what do you do first when you get this question? It's a bit of a trick question. Before you check anything.
Guess.
Before you guess. Read the question, thank you. So the first thing you should do is read the question. Like, you're going to think, oh, of course I'm going to read the question, but people every year forget to read the question properly. Like, they read the first half and the last half. That would actually be fine. The first quarter and the last quarter. They missed them. So don't do that. Be a cool person and read the question. So in this case, we're going to read, okay, we've got a hash include so we can print stuff out. We have a function called f that takes in a pointer to a character called s. If not star s. Okay, what does this mean? Possibly, that could be one interpretation. What else might it be? What did you say? Yep. So it's saying if not blah means like if blah and then taking the not, which is like inverting it, is true. So that's like saying if blah is equal to zero. That might have blown your mind a bit, so I'll try explaining it again. So if not blah means if this expression not blah evaluates to true, which is 1 or 2 or 3 or 5 or negative 1 or negative 5 or anything apart from 0. So that's like saying if we take this value, whatever blah is, and then not it, which means like, I guess if it's anything other than 0, make it 0, and if it's 0, make it anything other than 0. So if we do that and then this thing evaluates the true, then the if statement will continue. So in this case, it's like saying if we have blah equals 2. So not 2 equals 0. And so this 0 is going to evaluate to false, and so we're not going to go inside the if statement. But if we have blah equals 0, not 0 equals 1, 1 is true, so it's going to go ahead. Does that make sense? You look like you just understood something. Hopefully you do. Mind blown? Cool. Yep.
How do you know what's not something you can see?
Okay, so simple like key, like table you can look up in your mind. If it's a 0, not 0 equals 1. If it's anything other than 0, not anything other than 0 equals 0.
Okay.
So it's like a truth table, where we have 0 and 1, and then not. So not 0 is 1, 1 not 0. I don't know how truth tables work. Is this a truth table even? I don't know. But we also have all the values 1, 3, and infinity, and all of those will become 0.
So we're basically treating all the integers as 1.
Yeah, so it's just treating anything other than 0 as being 1. Cool. Alright, so now hopefully this will make sense. If not star s means if star s equals 0. So if s is a character pointer, when will star s equal 0? End of string, perfect. When it's a null pointer, like if your string is, you know, hello, null pointer, this is going to be not 0, not 0, not 0, and then it's going to be 0. So this is saying if we've reached the end of the string, return. Cool? So if we haven't, then continue on. We're going to call f of s plus 1, which means it's recursion, which means you should be a little bit scared, but not too scared. And then we're going to put char star s. So what's put char star s going to do? What does the put char function do? Yeah, it outputs a character. So what's star s going to output? The character that's currently being pointed to by s. Cool. Alright. So that'll print out whatever the current character is at this point is pointing to. So in main, we're going to call kernigan, this word that I can't pronounce, and then we're going to print a new line. So let's write this up here. Whoa. That was not expected. So we have. And then null. And so when we call our function the first time, I might write this out there. S then we're putting k. Cool. So we're getting up come up here. The current thing under s is the k. So k is not zero, so we're gonna keep going. Then we're gonna call f of s plus one, which means the character after the first character, which is also known as the second character. So our second function call is going to be like this s is going to be standing at the e and going along. Are you like talking about me or are you all good? Okay, a little bit nervous for me to talk in here. All right, so the second time we call it, it's going to be pointing to d. Once again, it's not null, so it's going to keep going. You might notice that I've skipped this line, but that's because we're still inside the function call. And so this function happens, it's like copying and pasting this and putting it in here, and then so on. So we will eventually get to this, but we're not up to that yet. So we're going to call another function. That's going to be here, and then another function that's going to be here. Dot, 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 until we get to the null. So we're going to have like a bunch of function calls, and s is going to be currently pointing to the null, so it's going to return. So now we're going to go to the one before it, which is the last character that's not a null, which is the n. We've just finished this function call because we've returned from when we called this on the null. So we're going to put char star s. So what's that going to print out? Cool, it's going to print an n. So here is our output. Cool. Then that function's going to return out of the end of this. And then we're going to go back, you know, down our upper stack frame, like to the previous function, which is going to be the one put into the a. So what's that going to do? Yeah, it's going to print out a, and then it's going to print out h, g, so on and so forth. So then at the very end of the first call, it can print out a case, so we have this printed out backwards. Just like zero the whole thing. Cool, so now this function call is going to return. It's going to do this, print out a new line, and it's going to return zero. So, what's the output of this function going to be, or this program going to be? Yeah, this in reverse, plus a new line. Cool, so if I was marking this, it might be like one mark for that and n minus one marks for getting that backwards. I don't know, did someone else mention it's marking status? But if you forgot to put the new line down, you probably wasn't marked. Cool, so this function, which at first you were like, it's pretty confusing what it's doing, you can tell by stepping through it and just following through the function calls, you're going to print out the string backwards and then a new line. Any questions? Yeah? I would write slash n. Yes.
Space.
I would just write this. Or like new line in brackets or something. Question?
When the function reaches the end of the string, which is the slash zero,
yep.
So the if does not fill it. The if the exclamation mark s is
right, because yeah, so this is gonna be true. Because remember, not of 0 makes it be 1. And because this evaluates to 1, it's going to go inside. Like, that's true, so it's going to go inside. Cool.
Why
don't we use
the slash?
For the slash 0. Right, so slash 0 is a special character. Like, if you remember ASCII values, the ASCII value of A is like 97 or something. The ASCII value of backslash 0, all in one word, is 0 itself. So when you print it out, or you can't print it out, but when you write it in code, like you'd write backslash zero inside single quotes, but it's a special thing for the operating system to know that it's ASCII value zero. Cool, any more questions?
At the put char star s,
no,
yeah, this one, why is that only one letter in printing?
Because char only prints a single character.
Oh,
right. So if it was put string or whatever the string one is, it'd print out the whole string from that one. So if S was pointing to G, it'd print out gar. Then it'd print out shy gar, then it'd print out M gar, and so on. Because it's a put char being a single character, it's prints one. Cool, any more questions? How are we doing for time? Way over time. Cool. Should I stop rambling, or?
Just continue on your strokes.
So what am I supposed to do next? Structs. So is structs also for 19121? Everyone?
Yep.
Alright.
I'm too expecting cues.
Alright, do you want to talk or do you want me to keep talking?
You can talk.
Alright, how do I thing this thing? I think I'm just going to shut it down.
Shut it.
It might have just broken everything. Right. What am I saying about structs? Do you guys have any questions about structs? Anything that's confusing? Yep.
So talk about the heading thing. Structs.
About the what?
The heading thing.
Heading thing?
Yeah. Twice.
Yes. What do you mean?
Like, you know how long we have to work out how many bytes what struct?
Ah, right.
Yeah.
So, like if you have a struct. So how many bytes big is this? Is that what you're asking? Right, so how many bytes big is the struct going to be?
How many bytes in an infinity?
Not
four? How many bytes is a character going to be?
One.
How many bytes is a character pointer going to be?
Four.
Cool. Is that tonight?
What are those padding things?
So do you have padding to vitalize it? Yes, so that will be four bytes. Okay.
Because these are tutorial questions.
I haven't tutored this course in this lecture, so I've never seen this before. But yeah, I can be convinced that this was going to be 4 instead of 1. So the reason that would be true is because when you have it in memory, so each of these is going to be 1 byte in memory. So this here is going to be it. And then the char is going to be here. But we can't have the int start yet. It's got to start by the time. So we can't have anything else in these three. So those four are going to be just start.
Well, why can't we just do start an object to
count? So the reason you can't, like, I don't think it's a rule. Is it a rule in the C standard? Does anyone know? Is this a C standard rule or a compiler rule?
The padding.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's a compiler thing. So when a compiler compiles code, it's more efficient for it to align things such that they're all in groups of like 4 bytes. So any variables that it has, it'll just have empty space in between so that you can access them. And I believe the reason that this happens, registers at 4 bytes, so good at the machine, right?
Yes.
So the reason that this happens is because that way you can, like with the actual CPU itself, it has things called registers which store variables that it can access very quickly. And so if it had, like this is the 4, and then if it had the char start here, when it tried to copy this into memory, it ended up copying the char and then the rest of the char start, so it didn't have like an incorrect amount of memory.
So it's always 4.
So it'll always be chunks of 4.
So that struct is 3 bytes of padding.
Yeah, so there's 3 bytes of padding. 1 plus. I think if you reordered it, so you had int, just char, the size would only be 9, but it would still have 3 bytes at the very end. It just would be at the end rather than between the variables. So I'm guessing you guys have seen structs. This is a struct. Struct blah, struggle bracket, some stuff, struggle bracket, semicolon. But I don't know what to say about structs. Like, they're pretty cool. They're also this, I guess. Yep.
Why is it a linkless name at the end of it? It's like,
always chuck
a name at the end of it. So, like, before, like, type
def. So type def, and then some stuff. So let's grab another color. You never had to move on. Can you guys read the green? So the stuff in black is a struct by itself. But we can also do a thing called a type def, which is where we do a type def and a struct declaration in one line. So a type def is this thing that simply says, type def, blah. So type def means whenever we see this name at the end, it actually means this thing here. So in the case of a simple type def, we could do type def char star high. So then we could type high instead of typing char star. That would be the equivalent thing to say. When we do it in struct, what this means is that we can refer to our struct blah just by saying blah. So we can find the type def. Everything before the last word and the last word being blah means that blah refers to this struct. We could also do it in 2 lines, and we just have the black stuff. And then afterwards we could say type def struct blah blah. So that means whenever you say struct blah, because remember a struct without a type def has to be called blah and see. So whenever you see struct blah, it's actually called blah. Sorry, whenever you see a blah, it's actually called struct blah.
Can you name, can you meaning that struck while it lasts.
Yes.
Yeah.
I did it last night. Okay. It worked. Might have been C++. I'm pretty confident it works. You couldn't call it struct blur. A, because it's two words, and B, because it's already wasn't called struct blur. I don't think you can call it int, for example, because it's like a protected word. But you can call it whatever you want. Cool. Any more questions about structs? Yes.
Sometimes they leave the blur out, like just struct.
Yeah, so just struct.
Is that does it matter which way you do it?
So if you have a type def, this is fine without a word, because you can refer to it by blur. If you don't have a type def and you make a struct, how do you refer to it? Like, you can't just say struct because you're going to be struct something. So if there's no type def in either of those, I don't know if it's a compiler error or if it's just like not going to be referable to, but you can't talk about it on this sort of name of some sort. Cool. Any more questions? Yep.
So you get a floating point number stored in memory.
Yep.
It takes up 4 bytes.
Yep.
And that's made up of 32 bits in like binary. How is the point, like the actual decimal point stored? Is it?
This is a little bit of a harder question than you think. The answer is I haven't got it memorized, but it can sort of make it so. The way that an int is stored is pretty simple, right? You've got 32 binary bits, and then you refer to them from binary to like decimal, and that's a number. Yep, so that's all good. Like, so if you had 1000, that would be 1 like this. Simple, nice, easy to translate it, I guess. Like, humans don't understand this. Floating point numbers, on the other hand, are not as simple. We have a person who probably knows this. How many bytes for which things? Is it like 13, and then 32 minus 13, and then 1? We have 1 byte for assigned bit.
8, 23, I think.
8? Oh. I'm just going to put some number. So we have K, and we have J, and then 1 for the assigned bit. So the assigned bit is like an int. If this is set to 1, then it's a negative number, and if it's set to 0, then it's a positive number. Then we have the rest of the numbers split up into 2 parts. One part is called the exponent, and one part is called the metric. So, exponent is like in scientific notation. I really have to explain this in like 6 months. We have like 2 to the 5. No. It's times 10, right? Like 1.23 times 10 to the 5. That's scientific notation. Have you guys seen this before in like maths or whatever? So this is like saying 1, 2, 3, 0, 0 as a number. Yes. Yes. Cool. So this part here is called the mantissa, and this is called the exponent. And so those are the 2 numbers that get represented in your floating point number. So this 1.23 will be stored, presumably as 1, 2, 3, and then this 5 will get stored. Am I wrong? I'm probably wrong.
That's about right.
It's about right, yeah. That's
what you're saying. Yeah, it's 23 bits of mantissa, 8 bits of exponent, and a signed bit for a eventual float.
Signed bit for what?
That's for a 32-bit float.
For yeah,
double,
yeah. For double, it's. Times by some
52.11.1.
Yes. Of course, because not. Okay, so if we have an 8-bit exponent, what's the biggest 8-bit number we can store? It's 1 byte, so it's like a character. So that means we can store numbers up to 255. So we can store numbers that are like 1.23 and extend to the 255. So this is the biggest number that a float can store, roughly. And negative whatever is roughly the smallest number we can store. And then this part here can be 23 bytes of precision, 23 bits of precision. So that's about all I remember. That's about all you need to know for the exam. Basically, there's a mantissa, which is this part, and an exponent, which is this part. And then they combine together with the sign bit to make it float. Are you more confused than you already started, or less confused?
I still don't know how you get the point there.
Right. How do you get the point? So there's this really good, you explained this to my class, that was good. But no, there's this really cool tutorial I saw the other day
What every programmer should know about floating point numbers. So you should all read this. Especially because if you add 0.1 plus 0.2, you might get 0.300004, because floats are really scary. Right, it's a binary fraction, right? You can explain. I don't know. Oh, you guys can't even say that thing.
Okay, so with floats, there's three bits like Sarah was saying. The first bit has basically a binary number, an integer number. So for example, the number might be...
Harry, do you want to write on that side?
Yeah. So the number might be 4. And then there's lots of zeros here. So this is the number in the 23 byte bit. What happens is, let's just ignore the sign for now. The exponent multiplies this number. So it's like, you know, scientific notation. So for example, you got like 2 × 10³ or something, right? The exponent, say the exponent of this was 2. So, yeah, 2. What would happen is it multiply 2 to the power of this. So this is like times 2 to the 2. And this is 0, and then there's 23 zeros in here, one point that. So when it multiplies, it's actually a binary number. So this becomes like, these all move forward to binary, so that binary decimal place moves back to places. Does that kind of make sense? Yeah.
Is that one at the front? Is that the sign?
So when you're doing floating point numbers, it always adds a 1. So there's always a leading 1 on. So
are you sure?
Yeah.
Pretty sure that's not right.
So
when you have zeros,
then there's
a fraction leads to 1. So you get the binary fraction 1.1.
Yeah. So there's a special value for 1. There's like a special, sorry, for 0. There's a special sequence for 0. So floats always have an extra 1 at the start. Any other questions about that? That probably wasn't the best explanation. But anyone still confused? Like, if you ask me a specific question, I can probably explain it better. One way to practice with these is really good. Is there's a if you Google like float converters, there's one that shows you the binary as you're doing it, and you can tick and untick the bits. I think it's like the first or second result on Google, and that makes it really easy to see. Like, it tells you the decimal value and it tells you what it is in binary. So that's probably the easiest way just to mess around with it. Alright.
Cool. Does that answer your question? Sorry, I got distracted and didn't know what you said, but I'm sure it was good because it was good when you explained it and the one that.
Thank you.
Hang on, let me work out what I'm supposed to be talking about next. Lists. I can do a list. Cool. Are there any more questions about structs, since we were originally doing structs? Cool.
Alright, so next up is linked lists. Does this fill you with excitement or horror?
Slightly.
I'm seeing a couple of excited people and a couple of horrified people. This is why I shouldn't be able to write a workload. Alright, so I might have some volunteers again, because it's easier than trying to draw stuff on the whiteboard.
Who gets the next?
Yes. Can I get maybe 5 people? You better be good, because I'm giving you a snake in advance.
Snake, yeah.
But the studies have shown that if you give someone a free thing, and then ask them to do something, they'll do it. But if you say, I'll give you a free thing, if you do something, they won't actually do it. Anyone else?
Thanks.
Ready? Anyone else coming up? I've forgotten your name again. Do you want to snake anywhere?
I'd like to snake anywhere.
Do you want to come and be a volunteer? What was your name again?
Jordan.
Jordan, yes. There's too many names. I forget my best friend's name. Yes.
Tragic.
Yeah, it's like I'm going to show you the hat.
Okay, so we have 4 of you. It's probably enough. Alright, so maybe we'll... Do you guys mind being on YouTube? Because you're probably
famous.
Volunteer if you're not going to be happy with that. Should have said that already. Alright, so this is like live streaming YouTube. So sorry if you bother volunteers.
Hello, world.
Alright, so, linked list. Volunteers, what is a linked list? So a linked list is these lovely people. So I'm going to point at Jordan. Jordan's going to point at, what's your name?
Victor.
Victor? Victor's going to point at Maddie. Your name is Maddie, right? That'd be really good if it wasn't.
Yep.
And Maddie's going to point at Vivian. Vivian is going to point at Noel, so you can just put like across. Cool? Alright, so we are a linked list. What does this mean? Like, it just means you're pointing at each other, like, just people standing in front with their fingers pointing at people. So that's all linked list is. So what does a linked list do?
You're actually structs.
Yes, we are actually structs. So let's write up our struct. Let's say we have an int value.
Human value.
Yeah, we could do that, but then I'll forget your names, so that's too hard.
I've
got to get names
already.
I think you're
Victor. Victor, yeah.
Hey, Jordan?
Yeah.
Maybe and Maddie. Okay, I haven't heard of your names. Cool, that's awesome. Alright, so I have a node, a struct node. I contain a value, which can be. Are you guys all the same age?
No.
Do you want to say what age is in public?
Sure.
Let me just pick a number. So my number is like 20. What is your number going to be?
Can I also be doing that? Okay, I'll give you my age, I think.
Cool.
120.
120?
Yeah.
Cool.
You're looking 19. Good for it.
19.
Oh, yeah. I'm 19. Just 16. 16. Cool. Alright, I forgot my numbers again, but you guys can remember your numbers. Actually, why don't I have values that are this hand? Because then we can have 2 hands. So my value can be 4.
Zero.
What do you want your value to be?
42.
But it's something you can do with your hand. So like be 2.
I'll go 2.
Cool. And then you keep pointing.
3.
She's already 3. You can be 1. Cool. Okay. I promise this is going to be useful. So I have a struct node. My int value is 4. My node star next is a pointer, which is this hand, which points to Jordan. So Jordan, similarly, value 0 points to Victor, so along the list. So, what can we do with a linked list? One thing we can do is we can traverse the linked list. So, another volunteer. Are you going to be a volunteer? Okay, so Harry is going to be a node pointer, which means he's got an arm, but it doesn't have any rest of the point. Like, that's a big cut off. So, he's just an arm. So, you can be a current pointer, and you can point to me to start with.
Yeah.
So Harry is like node star current, and so we're saying node star current equals head. I'm the head of the list. So what can we do with this? Harry can print out my value, so we can print out current arrow value, which is going to be 4. Or we can go current equals current arrow next. So we can do that, and now he points to join. So we can do that again, current equals current arrow next, current equals current arrow next, current equals current arrow next, current equals current error next, and what happens now?
Now.
Segmentation. So we tried to dereference null, and once again the error was exploded, so that was pretty careless of us. Alright, so...
Now I'm undefined.
The program crashed, so everyone undefined really. So okay, hopefully you guys visualize this concept. We have physical things of memory that contain both a value and an address. So the value is the value that it's stored, and the address is the person that went to it. So even if we did this, you can stay here. You're going to come stand over here. You're going to keep playing in the right people there. And you guys are going to swap places. So even with this crazy thing, and I'll be back here pointing to Jordan, so we can still dereference along like that, like that. And why are you pointing to her? You should be pointing to Noel.
Yeah.
Well, you are Noel. Yeah, so even if the memory isn't contiguous, isn't next to each other, it isn't in the right order, we can still follow our list of left. Does this make sense?
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you, volunteers. You may sit down.
We have to move.
You're going to be volunteers again next time.
Oh, okay.
You already got one. Alright, so... what else do you need to know about the linked list? Like, it's not a prac exam for 1917, so that should be fine. Is 1921 or 1927 listening as well?
Okay.
So who has a prac exam?
1921.
And 1927?
Yeah.
Oh, 1921 will have the prac exam for linked lists. Okay. So coding linked lists is important then. Alright. What should we do? Should we write some code? Should we write some whiteboard code? Should we... Do you want to?
Oh, should we move to struct and
unit?
Move to what? Structs. Stacks and queues.
Stacks and queues, yeah, we could.
It's the last one I want to talk about.
Okay. Okay, cool. Alright, so, brief 30-second interlude aside, we're now going to talk about structs and, no, stacks. Stacks and queues. I swear I do have a brain somewhere. Alright, so people who are just coming in, welcome. Hello, I'm Sarah. I think you all know me. You might not. However, we have like a 2-minute break and you guys can all shuffle around. Okay, so we're still going to do stacks and queues and then binary search trees, and I think that's all the 1917 stuff. So if you're still here for 1917, well done. Almost at the end. Okay, so stacks and queues. I think I've talked about stacks already, but I like to do my demonstrations. So I'm going to Can I borrow your phone?
Yeah.
It probably won't get broken. Alright, so, what phones? I didn't steal your phones. Alright. So, a stack is a pretty simple data structure. It's like a physical thing that you can visualize. So, if I have a stack, which is doing over here, you might have to say that. So, I have a stack of erasers and phones. So, I can push things onto the stack, which means I pile them up. So I'm going to push this eraser on. I'm going to push Michael's phone. So I can push things, which means I build the stack up like this. I can also pop things, so that popping things means taking the top thing. So I'm going to pop off that phone, push on this phone, push on this phone, and run out of phone, so I'm going to pop them off. So I can pop them off. And you'll notice that the one that went on most recently is the first one to come off. This one's here. Thank you. Does that make sense? We have a data structure, we can do it with physical things. We pile them up, it grows taller, then we take them off the top. All good? That is a stack. Now, on the other end of things, we also have a queue, which is the exact opposite of that. So we add things on, and then the first one that we added comes off first. So it's like if you imagine you're lining up in a grocery store to check out, people who line up first in the very front are going to be the ones who come off first. Hopefully. So if you've been queuing up and then people line up behind you, you will be the first person to check out, then the person behind you, the person lines up. Cool. What else do, like, do we need to code them? Or? Do you guys have any questions about stacks and queues? Yes. Okay, so I haven't like tutored this course this semester, so it's not a word I heard before like when I read the notes for this lecture. But a quack is, I believe, also called a deck in like sane worlds. So DQ, I've heard it called deck. DEQUD, double ended Q. Also a quack, which is a queue and a stack combined, like a doorway. But also a dump, like my quack. So these are the same thing, they're different words for the same thing. It's just a data structure where we can put things on either end and take things off the other end.
Might as well.
So I haven't really planned this very well, but if I could get like I have 30 is divisible by 5. Okay, so if I can get 1 through to 6 over here, 7 through to 12 over here, 13 through to 20, I've lost time.
Did you say 1 through 5?
Did I say 1 was low? No, 5 through 6. So 1 to 6, 7 to 12, 13 to
35.
18. Okay, that
helps.
19 to 24, and then 25 to 30. People who are watching on YouTube, it's going to be really boring for you guys for like 5 minutes, but it's going to be really, really fun. So just get with it. Is there anybody here who's not comfortable with being on camera? Right, people, let's think for a second. Is there anybody here who's not comfortable with being on YouTube? Because if not, then I'll point the camera, but if anyone doesn't want to, then that's fine.
I don't want to be famous.
Alright, so you guys are looking at this. How many of you guys are doing on that today?
Yes.
Most of all of them. Have you heard of So what's going to happen is everybody's going to be watching a dance and trying to just talk. So you guys will be able to do this. Okay, so discuss amongst yourselves.
Okay. I think it's going to be a little swinging around, because otherwise I don't take it. Yep. Just like, just push it out. No, we shouldn't be afraid. I'm just like, we can't. So we want to practice just to make sure that we remember to like check the to do it all in the way.
Cool. Alright, that's gonna
be nice. Oh wait, which way are we sorting?
It doesn't matter, I'm pretty sure we're all let's just all stand in order. This way.
Yes. Oh, we need to stop. Yeah.
Oh, no, we need to stop.
Oh, come on.
Puppet burger is always one of my
favorites.
Hey guys, you want one? Okay. I'm just from the restaurant.
It's immensely complicated. Actually, merge stop between the two. Until you get down to the bottom of the page, and so
Yeah, well, then they say.
Yeah, and then you just get pretty switch of things. And then the thing is really easy for us. You just go learn one thing until you have something. Until the next one. And then you don't need to create new words, though. You just do it again. Memory will find it. It's very
good.
Yeah. So it was like when I had it.
Did you say you bring it back?
The balls?
No, you.
So it's like, Josh, can you bring some balls? Like, shout. So I went like, what's some balls and Danish? And I handed the bag and I take my Danish out. And she's like, how much are you? And I'm like, so what papers in the bag? Minus the Danish. Well, I could have charged you for Danish.
Yeah, you can close it.
I can break dance.
We found the number station, which is like the very place that you can use, which if you write down all the numbers, convert them to ASCII, you get a message.
Can you do this? Are you prepared?
Which like was talking about their secret agent that someone might be able to do. Something about having access to like hundreds of students who are like defected.
Great. Is everybody ready? If you're ready, do you want to sit down at your seat? So these guys are going to get assault, and then once that finishes, everybody on the south. Okay. Come
in.
And so you just swap the elements that are out of place, and you keep on doing that as you go along. And each time you don't have to swap quite as many elements, and eventually you get
done. And everything's solved.
Yeah. So
how do you set your program to get the microphone?
It's a very complicated process. If you want to see the source code later, talk to me.
Thank you guys. You can hold on to it for now. It may be necessary later. Does this group want to come up? So don't say
it's not
your
own. I think bust this up.
Is it where Michael's at?
Which way is random
order? Random order.
Random order.
Big step forward.
Where's the camera?
So we're gonna start.
One step forward. You need to step out. Alright, okay. Now it's your turn. Compare with him.
Okay.
Now it's
Alright.
We swapped. Why did we swap the way we ordered it?
Yeah,
it's supposed to
be.
We just guess,
alright?
Well,
move out.
Move.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Good job, guys. Where are we going?
So exertion sword is basically you start with the first element in the list, and then you get the next element in the list, and you find where it fits in the new list or new array, and then you go to the second element. Do the same thing, so you look at the element already in your way, find your spot, you plug it in, keep going.
Yeah.
All the sorts of things.
Can we get another group over there somewhere?
I mean,
do we have another group over there?
She's letting the team down.
This way, down that way. Right. Then we gonna raise a hand when we're gonna
just
we go along the list. We all gonna
Nothing personal.
Okay, we won't stop with you.
You gotta keep going. No. Yeah. Repeat and repeat. Selection sort is basically you choose either the highest or lowest elements in the array, so you've got to go through and find the max or the minimum, whichever way you do it. Then you swap it to either the highest highest point or the lowest point. And then eventually you bring it back and you swap to the second highest, the third highest, until eventually it's sorted. It's order n squared. Quick shout out to everyone watching at home.
Are we not in order?
We're just standing in order.
Yeah, okay.
Just
We split it.
Yeah.
Split again.
Join back together.
Join.
I'm going
to tell you.
Alright. Yeah,
we're gonna get a drink. Yeah, one of you guys can play with us.
Oh, I'm going with them now. Oh.
Yeah. You guys know.
We were Hicksaw
guys. Radix, we're Radix. Radix.
So this was Merge Sword. And Merge Sword works by splitting the array in half. And each time you split the array in half, until you have any two elements and you compare the two elements, and you compare the two arrays next to each other and keep comparing until they merge. Awesome.
Oh my god, I can see myself.
Oh, I don't want to see that.
Just a question, are you going to keep going in all the 5 minutes now, or? This one.
Shall I go through all the sorts and then just
yeah.
Okay. So, everyone here, tell me a sorting algorithm. What sorts of MS? Is that all the sorts?
What's the one above the search?
Alright, so for your exam, you need to know how each of these sorts works. Not necessarily the coded, but to like pseudo-coded, like describe the algorithm. You need to know the complexities, so the average, the best, the worst case complexities. And you need to know how you can come across the worst case complexities. So we'll start with Bogosort. Best case complexity?
One. Okay.
Yeah, order n. Why is it order n and not order one?
Because you have to move the element.
Because you have to check if it's sorted at the end? Yes. And checking if it's sorted takes order n. Okay. Probably not going to be asked that in the answer. What about shell sort? That's hot. Let's move on. What about counting and bucket sort? So what is counting and bucket sort? Anyone know? Yeah.
You count the number of. So you work out the place each item needs to hold by counting the number of things smaller than it, going along using that. Yes.
That's not the one I've heard of.
That's why. Yeah, I don't know why they keep counting slash buckets because they're different. As far
So the counting sort that I've heard of is where you go along and you count the number of elements that happen. So, for example, if you find a 1, you increment your 1 bucket. If you find a 2, you increment your 2. If you find a 100, then you increment your 100. And then at the end, you go through your list of, like, I had 5 1s, I had 6 2s, I had 1 3. And so you print out, like, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and so on. So what's the complexity of this going to be?
It's n plus
k. Yep. So it's going to be where n is the number of items and k is the range of items, or the other way around. So basically, if you've got numbers that are going to be between 1 and 100 for student IDs, which are between, I don't know, 3,000 and 5,000 or something, 500,000, whatever. Like, if you've got numbers and the range is smaller than the number of elements you've got, then it can be a really good sort to do because you can kind of condense them all. Cool. What about the best and worst case complexities of that? We had n plus k. Is that the same always, or is there a worst case? Yeah? Yeah, it's always going to be that complexity. There's no best or worst case, it's just the average. Cool. Quicksort. How does Quicksort work?
That's a pivot, and then it sorts outside of the pivot.
Yeah, so quickly is a good answer, I mean, compared to, like, yeah, so we have a pivot, and then we go through, find everything smaller than the pivot and put it on one side, find everything bigger and put it on the other side, and then we take those two groups and then go through and resort those. Cool, what's the best case complexity?
Yeah,
I should probably write this down. So, alright, what's the average complexity? Yep. And log n again. And what's the worst case complexity? Yep, and when is it going to be n squared? What is the worst case? Yeah, if we have the worst possible choosing the pivot. So if we're quick sorting a sorted list, and we always make the pivot be the last one, then the first time we're going to go through this, 5 is going to be the pivot,
So then we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. And then 4 is going to be the pivot, then we're going to go 1, 2, 3, and then 3 is going to be the pivot. So we're not actually moving anything, and we're going to have the same number of pivots as there are items in the array, which is going to be n squared. Well, we actually have a reverse sorted list, so instead of being 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. What's the complexity going to be for that? Slow is a good answer. As slow as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Slower or the same? Less slow.
Same.
Yeah, so it's going to be the same worst case, whether it's sorted or like ordered or reverse ordered. Cool, what about merge sort? How does merge sort work? Saw that before? Yep, so we split the list in half, then we split those in half, we split those in half until we just have two or one element. Then we sort those, and then we merge back the sorted list until we have one sorted list. So what's the complexity of that going to be? Who thinks n? Who thinks n log n? Who thinks something else? Yeah, n log n. So why is it going to be n log n?
Because it doesn't do it linearly.
Yes, so the way that I like to think about this, like you can prove it formally using the master theorem, and that's like COMP1921 and stuff, but I don't know how to do that. So the way that I look at it is like, if you have this many elements, then we're going to split it in half. I'm going to split those in half. So the number of times you have to split is like, if you imagine this being a binary tree structure, so the first level is going to have one list, second level is going to have two lists, third level is going to have four lists, and then we're going to have eight lists, and so on. So this is like the structure of a binary tree, and so the height, like the number of times you have to do this step is going to be the height of the binary tree, which is going to be log n. So it's like n times log n to log n. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Cool. So it's, is that always going to be the complexity, or is it sometimes going to be faster or slower?
Always.
Yeah, always. So there's no worst case that's going to be slower. Alright, what about radix sort? What is radix sort? Anyone?
Well, from the least acknowledged to the...
Least is what? Digit. Yeah, bit or digit, depending on how we do it. So the easiest way to visualize it's going to be doing it by digits. Yeah. So if these are the numbers that we have, then we're going to start by sorting by either the most or least significant digit. So in this case, we'll do the least, which means 2. So we're going to order them like that. So it's going to be 2, 2, 3, 4, 6. So that's going to be 1, 3, 2, 5, 6, 4, 5, 6. And then, what else is wrong?
Do you got to sort the second?
Yes. Do we sort all of them, or do we sort them in buckets?
You sort buckets.
Yeah, it's going to be buckets by the last digit, right?
Three, yeah. So everything. One would be at the top. So 3, 1, 4. Then 1, 2, 4, 6.
Isn't it going to be... I'm confused myself.
I'm confused myself.
I have confused myself more than I was originally. Brief tangent. So we sort by the last digit. And by sort by, I mean we put them into buckets, so we have a bunch of buckets and then we put them in that based on the last digit. And then we go through again, we keep the order that they came into the buckets, then we sort them by their actual digit. So it's going to become 312, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we sort them by their first digit. So they're going to maintain their relative order within their buckets, but they're all in the buckets, so they'll just go in order. So we're going to move. Like that. And then we can just take the order that they went into the buckets and then read them out from left to right across the buckets. Then they'll be sorted. So this is going to be, we have to do it once for each number of digits in the number, or otherwise we can do it based on the number of bits in the number if we want to do it that way. So what's the complexity of this going to be?
It's gonna be 3 and.
Why 3? Is this 3 digits?
Yeah.
So it's gonna be n times k, where k is the number of digits in the numbers. Cool. Right. Is there a best and worst case, or is it always gonna be n times k? Guys, hello! Listening, please. Is it always gonna be n times k, or is there a best and worst case? Always? Cool. What about selection sort? You saw that before? So selection sort, we go through and select the right one?
Oh, radix sort. What if you have different strings like this? One is four. So we still sort the largest first.
So if you have one that's 4 long and the rest are 3 long?
Yeah.
So you still sort by the last number?
Okay.
So if you had this, then that would be in that bucket, and then it would go in the 3 bucket, which is this one, and then it would go in the 2 bucket, which is this one. And then we'd do one like iteration ignoring, like where n zero is the side of all bits. No, because these are less than 1.4.
If you were trading with the spread,
it still makes sense to put zeros at the start. Depends on how you define sort. Okay, so selection sort, we go through and select the right element. So if we have a list of elements, we go through, we find the smallest one. So we look through all the elements, find the smallest one, put it in a new list. Then we go through again, find the smallest one, put that in a new list. Keep doing that until we have nothing in our old list and everything in our new list. So what's that complexity going to be? N squared, n times n. So we're doing one whole pass through the array is going to be order n. And because we're doing n times, it's going to be n times n, which is order n squared. Cool. What about insertion sort? same thing, the opposite. So instead of finding the right one and then inserting it, we do just take the next one along and then insert that in the right place. So it's easy to choose the next one and hard to put it in the right place, as opposed to hard to choose the next one and easy to put it in the right place. So the complexity is also going to be into it. Bubble sort. In squared, you saw that before. And heap sort. Have you guys all seen heap sort? For those of you who haven't, you put everything into a heap and then take it out of here. So, the question then is, what is the complexity of adding something into a heap?
Is it n squared?
It could be.
But n is really small.
N is always going to be the number of elements.
But you start off with, like, no elements.
So that's going to be on average n on 2, which is still order n squared.
Sure.
But this is not order n squared. So if we insert something into a heap, have you guys covered heaps? They're basically like binary search trees, but instead of being a binary search tree, they're a heap. So the binary search tree, left is smaller and right is bigger. Yes, but we'll be with that first. So BSD, this way is small, this way is big.
Yes.
Do you
originally
use an array?
You can do it with an array or a tree. I'll show you the cool array thing. With a heap, the rule is that going down is bigger, or going down is smaller if you want. So, a valid heap would be like 1, 5, 3, 9, 100, 4, 6. So it doesn't matter that this one is smaller than this one, because this is its parent. So as long as each child is bigger than its parent, this is a valid heap. So insertion into this is going to be order of log n, like with a binary search tree. We just insert it in the right slot, and then wiggle it around so it works. So what number do you want to insert? 42, let's say. We insert it just in the next free spot, and then we swap them until it's in the right place. So 42 is bigger than 9, so it's fine. Then the next free slot we can insert 2. So 2 is smaller than 9, so we swap them. 2 is smaller than 5, so we swap them. And it's bigger than 1, 3. So you can see it's going to be at most log n swaps to get it up to the top. Cool. So insertion being auto log n, deletion is also auto log n because we just take this one out from the top, put the rightmost, bottommost child in, and then swap it around until it's about here. So that's also going to be auto log n. So the complexity of heap sort is take all your numbers, put them into the heap, which is going to be n times log n, and take them all out of the heap, which is going to be n times log n. So it's 2 n log n, which is equivalent to order n log n. Order n log n. Cool. Are there any questions about these sorts or the complexities? Do you want to jump? What's up next? What'd you say?
Keep on saying yes.
Oh, I'm not doing that. It's already 5 o'clock, so we can keep on this.
Priority queue is user matic or matic?
It depends on how you define your priorities.
Right.
So if you want big numbers to be the better priorities, then you do a mix. If you want the smaller ones to get higher priority, you do a C. Yep.
We'll call the external merge. External merge, the file one.
What do you mean by external merge?
It's a file A and file B.
Oh, so if you've got two sorted files, how do you merge them?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Is that like, do you want me to explain that? Or what's the question?
Is it like just like put the A and B together, then merge that system?
Yeah, if it's
like 3, 4, something like that.
Yeah, cool. Are there any more questions? Alright, so pointer arithmetic, everyone's favorite topic, especially at 5 o'clock after standing up here for however many hours. But pointers are really fun, and hopefully you guys will agree with me eventually. If not, then we'll just make you repeat the squats until you do. I guess the key thing is with like. So the key thing with pointer arithmetic is that pointers and sync smart, and they know what type they're pointing. So if you have. So we have int a equals 5, and int sub p, so p is a pointer, points to a, so equals the address of a. Actually, let's do this differently. Let's make the array. So A is an array of size 10, and it contains 10 numbers chosen at random. And P is the address of A, so P is pointing to the first element in A. So if I said P plus plus, what would happen? Yeah, the point is like an element. Cool, so if you imagine P, to do. Alright. What about if P was pointing to a character? So for some reason we have char star Q is the address of A. We ignore the compile error by saying like cast A with char. I don't know if that's real syntax, but we casted it to a char. So now Q is pointing to the first thing in the error. What happens if we go Q plus plus? Josh looks sad, yep.
Types are different, so. There's something underlined.
Nope, it's definitely fine. Yep.
Yeah, we'll try and read the last three bytes of the first element and the first byte of the second element.
It's pointing to a character, so it's only going to care about one byte.
Oh, okay, alright.
So, thinking back to numbers, right? The number 1 is 0x01 0x00 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 but the compiler knows that this makes up 180. When p points to here, when q points to here, the compiler goes q is a character, characters are one byte, so it only points to this byte. So when we say q plus plus, q now points to this one byte of the int. Whereas if we say p plus plus, p now points to this group of four bytes. Does that make sense? So basically, if we have a character pointer that points to something that's not a character, it'll just read it as if it was a character, so it'll read the individual bytes. I think when I saw this in 1917 last semester, Richard did this in like one of his live lectures. It was very confusing, like the Goldilocks one.
What about a void pointer?
Ah, so void pointers, you can make them, but you can't do much with them. So what letter am I up to? P, Q, what's the next living alphabet? R. Okay, so we have a void pointer R. What is a void pointer? Like, void is a type, I guess, but you can't make a void. Like, I can't say void Q equals 5. It's not valid. But I can make a thing called a void pointer. And the reason you'd want to do this, because normally with pointers you want to go, oh, okay, it points to a type, and so you know what the type is, and you can do the program. But if you have a function that can take in different types, and you don't know which type it'll be in advance. So for example, like if you use qsort in the libraries in C, so in C standard lib or something, you can use qsort, which takes in a comparison function. And so you have to give it a comparison function, and that expects two void pointers, because you can compare any type of item you want. So you can compare ints, you can compare characters, you can compare structs. And so we're passing in a void pointer type thing, you can then pass them to a valid pointer inside the thing, and then compare them from there. So, yeah, I can't make my void pointer equal to 0 sub A. I can't even pass that to like a char star or anything. there's nothing I can do like that that's going to make sense. But what I can do is I can pass something in as a void pointer, so if my function expects. Like this, I can call func on A. Just A, let's make that be a Q. So that's passing in a pointer, and then inside func, I can say, actually, well, I think it's.
Better cast that too. So that goes in there.
And then I can refer to A rather than Q. Are you all confused beyond measure, or less confused than you were 10 minutes ago? Someone's asleep. I'm doing well. You're welcome to sleep. There's like desks at the back if you want. Does this stuff make sense? Like, yeah.
If you were to type class Q as an int,
yeah.
Would that read the first, the last three bytes and then the first byte of the next?
So you're saying if I have this character pointer and it's pointing here,
yeah.
And then what am I doing with it? So I'm doing like printf snd, and I'm passing it what?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would go and take this chunk and interpret it as an int. I believe. Yep.
What if you start Q plus points?
That is a good question. I would say try it and see because I don't know for sure. I believe what it does is it interprets it like. I'm not going to get this wrong. So D references Q and then plus plus. But the other interpretation would be to take the star Q plus plus, which would just be D referencing it. So basically, if you want to use this, put brackets in.
But if the above one, it just adds the value.
Yeah, so this one here takes this value of the next one. So then it'll take two, for example, this character. So then it'll take this slide here and make it one as well instead of zero. So this number is now unplugged. 157?
Yeah. Yeah, but it's wrong.
Yeah, so if you fit as an integer, it increments like 4 or
2
or 5. Cool. Alright, what's up next, Michael? Yeah, question? Sure.
Breaks continues.
Does anybody want me to talk about breaks and continues?
How about hashtags?
Ledger,
I think, yeah. Because we're still doing 191 stuff as well as
191. Yeah, so. Number generator.
Okay, if you want to see Jabrano number generator, hash include standard lib, and then type srand.
Can I do recursion?
Blah. See, is the recursion up next?
Recursion 1927.
Really?
Yeah.
191 number recursion. 1917.
Right, so does this recursion randomly limit it to 1 second? So like you generate 1 second per second, doesn't it generate?
So the usual convention is to call this rand. So what this does is this, given the current time, it returns it in seconds, and it uses that value in the scene to the right number generator. So this will change once per second if you call it a
so if you call it the millisecond when you want, doesn't it generate the same number? So the number you generate is only different. After this you call it red, right?
Yeah, so you can call this. You normally call this one.
Yeah.
Or you can call more than you want, I think, and then you can call RAM.
So the number only changes every 1 second.
No, the random number should change every time you call it.
If it's in a while loop, like the execution time is less than.
Does that So you're saying like this?
Yeah, so I'm going to do that. You're going to push it up to 3, 3, 3, 4, 7.
Right. So the reason that will happen is because you're resetting the random number generator, and how it works. So normally you call this once in the of your program, and then you call this. When you call RAD, it generates a number and then moves to the next number. Like generates a bunch of numbers at a time.
Have a dinner break?
Great. So, recursion is super fun and you guys should like it.
Okay, let's go.
So, you've all learned recursion, but it's a little bit confusing. Is that accurate or is some of you not a recursion?
Let's say you have a double recursion function.
We'll get to that. So let's do a simple recursion thing. Like with recursion, you have two cases, the base case and the recursive case. So whenever you're trying to solve a problem, you have to work out both when does it finish, like when are you finished solving it, and how do you relate your problems together. So the classic example is like Fibonacci numbers. So in the case of a Fibonacci number, we're given the recurrence relation, like the way that they relate together. So we know that fib of n, so the nth Fibonacci number, that's going to be equal to fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. So it's not always this clear. Like with tree traversal type stuff, you might be told like, calculate the number of leaves in a tree, in which case, like it's not so bad, but then you can kind of think about it and work it out. Maybe it was different match numbers, guys. So you have the recursive case, which is how do my problems relate to each other? So recursion is especially good for dealing with when you've got a big problem that you can break up into smaller problems. So the big problem might be calculate the 100th of a matching number. We can break it up into smaller problems, like how do we calculate the 99th and the 98th, because we add those together to get the 100th. And then if we want to do the 99th, how do we do the 98th and 97th, and so on. Until we do all the way back to doing the first and second and third, and so on. But if we didn't have some form of base case, if we didn't say like how we know when we're done, then they'd just live on forever and we'd eventually run out of cycles and die. So the base case is super important. How do we know when to stop? So in the case of Fibonacci numbers, we're given the base case as well, so we're told that the first and second are 0 and 1 Fibonacci numbers are going to be 1. So fib of 1 equals 1 and fib of 0 equals 1. So the second Fibonacci number will be 2, the third will be 3, and so on. So knowing these things, how do we turn this into a recursive program? It's pretty simple. We have a function called fib that takes in n. We have the base case. So if n is equal to 1 or 0, so if it's one of the cases that we know about already, then return 1. Otherwise, return fib of n. This 1 plus fib of n minus 2. Cool. So this is how we'd write the code for this program. How it actually gets called is quite interesting. So we effectively get this search tree. So if we want to know the 10th of my channel, it's here. Maybe the 8th one will be easier. So 8 is going to come down here. It's not 1 or 0, it's 8, so we're going to keep going, and we're going to return fib of 7, it's fib of 6. So we basically get this tree-like thing where 8 calls 7 and 6, and 7 is similarly fib of 6 and 5. 6 is 1, 4, 5, and 4. 3, 4, 3, 2, So what are you noticing here?
They all get the base.
Well, they have to, if they didn't get the base case, they might keep going forever until the base case is four. But there is one key observation to make here.
It does the same thing a lot of times.
Yeah, that's a really good observation to make. Is that all then yet? Why? I'm bored. So, as you can see, to call 8, you might think, oh, 8's not a very big number. That's like 8 operations, right? It's going to be 2 plus 4 plus 8 plus 16 plus 32 plus 64 down probably to a height to get into 1. So it's actually going to be 2 to the 8 operations rather than 8 operations to do this sort of function. But sometimes that's useful. Like if we actually have a tree and we do want to use this tree like structure. So if we have a binary search tree, if we have this binary search tree, then we do actually want to use the tree thing. So we want to start at 5 and call something on the left and right children. And call something on the left and right children, yeah. So if we wanted to work out the number of leaves in this tree recursively, we can write a function. So the recursive case is going to be given some tree. And when you're looking at the recursive case, generally you like simplify it down to a really simple problem. So the number of leaves in this tree is hard. The number of leaves in this tree here, it's just got 3, 2, and 4. It's 2 bits, right? So that's pretty simple. So that's going to be the number of leaves on the left, which is 1, plus the number of leaves on the right, which is 1. So you see that the recursive case is going to be, for the current tree, it's going to be left plus right. Cool. And then the base case, how do we know when to stop, is when we actually find the leaf node. So if it's got no left or right child, then we're going to return 1. Otherwise, we're going to return the left and right, sums added up. So we can do that over here. So if we're fast in the current route, let's have this there. So the base case is going to be what the base case is going to be. It's how we know when to stop. So when do we stop in this case?
If it's null.
If it's null, or we can stop if it's a leaf node. It's probably going to be more accurate since we can have the leaves. So if they equal each other and one of them null. So this is like saying if it's a leaf node, they won't return one. So this is like how we know to stop. And then the recursive case is how do we write them together? So it's going to be left and right added together. So as you can see, I like tricking the teacher because it's not right on the whiteboard. But these squiggles actually say return leaves function call root left plus leaves function call root right. Yeah.
What if you have a node which has something on the left but nothing on the right? That looks like a question.
Yeah. So what do we want to do in that case? If we have, like this is going to give us this situation, let's rub off the 12. So what should the answer be? How many leaves are there below 10?
Just one.
It's just one, right? So it's going to be 1 plus 0 is what we want it to have. So if it's a null child, we should then return 0.
Yeah, so why don't we do that as the base case instead?
Return 0.
T. So if this node equals a null, oh, I guess not.
Yeah, so the reason that's going to be a problem is because we're not counting the number of nulls. Because if we counted the number of nulls,
then
that
would work.
Oh, yeah, it will be 2 times the number.
It is C0.
No, it won't. Because for these ones, there'll be 2, but for this one, there's 1 null. So that doesn't mean it's a leaf.
Yeah,
so we could tell the difference between this and between this.
So we need another base case.
Yeah, so we need another base case. So if root is null, return zero. So in the prac exam, you'll do this, it'll crash on cases with only one child on leaf. You'll go, what's going on? And then you go to like think about it and stuff. Is this explained recursion any better than previously? Did that help you guys or should I keep going? I guess the hard part is working out what the recursive invasive case are going to be. And so for that, it's just a matter of practicing a bunch of times. So do all the live questions, do all the two questions. Cool. Do you guys have any questions about anything?
How do you go about finding out the time complexity for recursion?
Right. So the technical answer is the thing called the master theorem. And it's like this formula that you plug it into, but that's not expected in this course. I'm just forgetting my words. So the actual answer is draw one of these. So in this case, it's going to be like fifth of h. You can stop about this point, but you'll realize, it's going to be like n 2 to the n, right? Because it's going to be a height that's n 12. Sorry, a tree that's n 12. So then it's going to have, see later, that's going to have 2 to the n nodes. Whereas in this case, again, it's going to be 2 to the power of height, which is going to be the same as n, like the number of nodes. Do you have a like an example exam question that asks that?
I still
want
to go down on this one.
Do you remember roughly what the recursion was? Okay. Any other questions? Does that answer your question?
Sort of,
yeah. Sort of, like, drawing the sort of things we use, yeah.
Could we do it for collapse?
You'd have to tell me the formula.
So if it's odd.
Oh, that's the 341.
Yeah. Because I don't know what the complexity of that is.
That's Hailstone's, right? Hailstone's.
Yeah, sounds right.
So how does that work?
If it's odd, three times
solid. Three times n plus one.
Yep.
If it's even divided by n on two.
Is it recursive? Really just a loop.
You can do it as recursive. It shouldn't.
What is it? I can tell you what. So this would be our recursive case, and then our base case is going to be...
It's if equals 1.
So what do you want to return on the case? Like, what is the point of our function? Are we counting the number of sequences?
Number of steps. So just like add one to each of those.
So for those of you who are not familiar with it, this is like Hailstone sequences or the collapse conjecture which we had in 1.9. Was this wondrous numbers as well?
Yeah,
so this is also wondrous numbers. So the way it works is that you take a number, so let's say 5. 5 is odd, so we multiply it by 3 and add 1, so we get 16. 16 is even, so we divide it by 2, 8. Divide 8 by 2, 4, 2, 1. So if you multiply 1, odd, so that's going to be 4, and then 2, 1, 4, 2, 1. So we can stop and make it 1, it's always going to cycle. So we start with something else, like 6. 6 is even or odd? It's even, right? But 3 is odd, that's why it confused me. So that's going to give us 3, and then that's 10. 10 even?
Yeah, that's
5.
Oh,
I'm 16. So tired, yeah, 16. And the rest of that along. Eventually,
yeah.
And I believe it's conjecture, but not proven, that any sequence of numbers, like any number you start with, will eventually lead to 1, but it's not proven. Yeah. All right. So we've got this recursion function we made. So I went, okay, I know the rule. If it's odd, we do 3 n plus 1. If it's even, we divide it by 2. And then that's our recursive case, because it's our rule. And then our base case is if it's 1, then we're at the end, so we're going to return 1. So this will count the number of terms in a sequence. So how do we look at the complexity of this? I believe that this requires us to know the structure of the problem that we can't necessarily know. So this is going to take the number of steps in this tree is not based on any inherent property of the number. And if we could answer whether it's going to happen for every number or not, then maybe I'll go to the next equals. So, like, you can see for this one, it's going to be like 5 longer than that. It's not going to be, it doesn't scale the size of the input. So we could, one would be instant, but it's not like 5 is going to be 5 times as long as 1 or anything. So if you're asking the example of the complexity of this is, I think it's okay to write, I don't know. That would be a weird exam question. What would I know if that was an exam question?
You give like best case, average case, worst case.
So the worst case is...
The best case would just be 1, and the worst case would just be like infinity or something.
But it couldn't be infinity because we don't know for sure. Like, it's not
so you say worst case, I don't know. At least you've given a best case scenario.
Yeah, but the best case would be 1. It's never
ending. Hopefully John listening to us.
Yeah, I'll have to tell him for the next case exam. Right. So, any more questions?
Or,
which number was that? The one I... Ah, John Shepherd's watching the video. That's all. what was I looking up? Sample exam.
I'm going to edit the exam now.
What?
Where's
the
sample exam?
What is
this? I don't know. Ah, oh, that's really clever. Okay, you can look up the sample exam.
Oh, that's a really
cool use
of unions. I didn't think about
Sample
exams? Do you have it?
Four.
1927. Can you just tell me the question?
Yeah. So, basically, you have an operation that you're
So we have like the iteration not the shortest, so then we call it the list of items and then add to the tree.
We call it on that
same tree. And then now we've got two nodes in the tree.
What is it?
We've got to get all of them connected to A and C.
So split it. So this becomes
7 and 6.
Like
and then we discover that 2 has at least.
And we're searching for the biggest.
So we have B to the tree.
So we're going to return.
And now B. Now you can compare. You look at any series. No, the tree can look like that. Like one node can have many things connected to it. It's not a path.
So we're going to split it in half.
Yeah. It's just anything that's connected to anything in the tree or anything. So A, B, C. This is connected to the tree. I mean, this is the essential. Yeah, so the shortest path out of 6, 7,
to do it from
1 to 5 or 3.
Yeah, basically, and then you
add that to the tree.
And then you merge them together.
And now I just want to put everything that's connected to C, B, and A. So you've got 6, 7, 5, 4, 7 again.
It's going to be smallest
one is
6.
But B is going to be a tree, so it'll be like so the next one is 5. So you add E to the tree. And then
All the node trees are now in the tree.
On the central.
And if you work in the tree.
Is this still there?
Right. Goes on the. I have the. It's kind of like.
That's Prim's algorithm.
Solution and a question.
Yeah. But instead of choosing your vertex, you have to sort. It looks like the edges. Sort all the edges to the. In like an ascending order. So like the smallest edge wave to the largest edge wave. And then you add the smallest ones into the tree so long as it doesn't form a cycle.
Yeah, so it's like that. So if you do it like step by step, a lot of people.
Yeah, so let's do that.
Generated. So with the smallest edge, it can start anywhere, but it doesn't. So at this edge, and then both A and C are now in the tree. Then I look at the next smallest edge, and it doesn't need to be connected to the corresponding tree. It can be anywhere, but it's two, right? So we add B to the tree, and then. Say if I change this. We can demonstrate how it works. We did it originally.
Change this. Like it seems like it does like all of that.
So next edge I can consider is this one here. We can add this to the tree, even though it's not connected to the.
So what's going to happen?
That's okay. Because it has the smallest edge weight. And then the next smallest
is going
to be D, so we add that to a tree. Basically, if the next on cycle, we cannot add it to a tree. So the smallest one would add the tree quickly. But like, I couldn't add this thing to the tree, because as soon as I add this to the tree, it closes it, and then it has a circle, so you cannot do that.
So it's like we're working at so broken it up to zero. So now we're going to return the zero as zero.
It has a path. But it,
so it's like
but
going up a tree.
It can be trained.
So like this function is going to return the zero as zero. So then we're going to call 1 through 1 is going to be the right. And 3 is going to be the
right. That was a good example.
And then these two are going to be.
You consider the edges in order of weight.
So now
add it, see if it forms a loop. Doesn't,
we can add it to the second tree.
And the span of the tree is that is connected initially.
So now, you're out of finish, so we go. You're not trapped in the half that is going to be the net. So the part is.
I just don't know how to like once it's full, like a node is full, what do you do?
So it goes to kind of like
the people.
It's like this tree. Oh, yeah. It's all full. And so, so it's kind of like an invert. So it's like this one node that has two.
Yeah, I'm just wondering how to insert into a tree. Right, is there
any other topics we should cover? Does anyone have any questions about graphs?
Well, how would I do that?
I just that's not a graph. Stone streets? Oh, I'll show you my cool graph thing because we're
going to
graph
on
trees, okay?
Yep. There seems to be lots of different ways to when you're trying to find when you need to know which node you've already visited. What's the best way to do that?
Yeah, like graph.
When you're doing a breadth first or depth first.
How is your data stored?
Six of
them. How is your data stored?
JSON matrix or
whatever. Is that what I changed down to? If you go to JSON matrix, then you can just store, okay, like nodes. You can have an array of nodes. The visited and then you set it from 0 to 1.
Yeah.
That's probably the best way unless you can change the data structure. So really cool thing that I showed in the revision lecture I did ages ago. And this is really useful if you guys want to listen. Hello. Well, you can not listen, that's okay. So basically, you guys have heard of stacks and queues and queries. Okay, guys, seriously, if you don't want to listen, then you can like talk outside or something, because I can't talk if you're talking. Thank you. So you've heard of stacks and queues and priority queues, and you know how they work. A priority queue being heap. Yes, this is all good. So doesn't matter. So there's this really cool thing where Dijkstra's algorithm, the breadth first search, and a depth first search are all the same algorithm but with a different data structure. So I don't know if you've seen that before, but some people are mind blown when I told them. So basically, your data structure looks like, I mean, your algorithm looks like head start to blah, where blah is a stack, a queue, or a priority queue. Then while it's not empty, what the top? I don't know if you can read this. Yeah, so if you have a queue, it's going to go through and push the nodes on and then visit the first one first, and the second one second, and then like the last added ones will be visited last. So what algorithm is that going to be?
So, do you mean which?
Yeah, like so if you have the graph, like this, so we're going to start with 0. So we're going to go 0, then we're going to go to 2, then we're adding another queue, right? So we're going to add 1 before 3. So we're going to go to 1, then next we're going to go to 3 from 2, then we're going to go to 4 from 2. So what graph searching algorithm is this called? Yeah, breadth first search. If we use a stack, I'll use a different color. So we're going to add on, what would we really do? Add on 0 first, then add on 0's children, so 2 is the only child. Then we're going to add 1, 3, and 4, because those are the children in order. And then we're going to go to the first one. The most recent added one, which was 4, so it'll be next. And then we're going to add on 4's children, which are not, which should be interesting. So if we have the link here, we're going to visit 3 from 4 next, rather than, because we're going as deep as we can, gives away what it is. Then we have 1 and 2, so we're going to visit 2 from 3. Then we're going to visit this child last, so we've effectively gone around like this in one big chain. So that's called depth first search. So that's using a stack instead of a queue for blah. Yep.
Depth first search when you go straight from 3 to 1, because you've already built the district. So you went 0, 2, 4, 3.
Yes, because 2, 3 is in the next. Like that. I'm confused. There was another band. Oh well. And the thing is, priority queue, where these are weighted edges, and then we always pick the next smallest one off, or the next fastest one off. So we make these be like 10, 50, 5, 3, 7, 100. So we're still going to have to visit from 10 to 2 first. Sorry, from 0 to 2 first, because it's the order choice. But now that we're here, we'll add on all these children onto the priority queue. And then we're going to pick the smallest one, which is 5. Visit that. Then we're going to add on these children as well. So now I have all of these 4. The next smallest one's going to be 7. And again, we have an endpoint in mind, so we're stopping when we got to the endpoint. So let's say one day endpoint we're looking for. And we're going to add this child on, and bring it on there. So the next shortest one's going to be this one. And then of those children, that's the shortest one, and then we've reached our endpoint. Does that make sense? Did I blow your minds, or are you too tired for that? This blew my mind when I heard it first. So basically, if you remember this structure of code, you can do all three algorithms. It's very cool. Cool. Someone had a question about red light trees.